everyone.
Thank you all so much.
Thank you all so much for coming to see this year's senior projects. I'm proud to present the class of 2023's five or six senior projects, but you'll unfortunately only be able to see five of them today. Now, I know my classmates have been working tirelessly on these projects, and it's a major part of senior year. Ever since Green Meadow began, or the high school began in 1972, senior projects were the key part of senior year. Some of our teachers even did a couple of projects over the years. Our class advisor, Ms. Cowell, in 1987, did a senior project on directing a play herself. And I know this kind of makes sense for Ms. Caldwell to us right now, but we can see how the lessons she learned in her senior project translate to the work she's doing today as she will be directing our senior play. Now, I assure you, this is the same with my classmates. The skills and lessons they've learned in developing their projects are very relevant now, and they will be throughout their life. Without further ado, we'll start off with a presentation by Grace on the biography on her own, followed by Charlotte on Zoe presenting dressage. Then Charlotte on the Poshpilla project, Jasmine on creating an EP, and finally, Alexander Lopizzo on boxing. Let's get started.
So if you guys know me, you may know that I'm very close to my grandmother, Pauline, who I call Oma, the Dutch name for grandmother. And when I was little, she would always tell me stories about her childhood. My Oma has a very unique ethnic background and nationality. My family is ethnically Chinese from Hong Kong, but immigrated to Suriname, a small country once colonized by the Dutch in South America, where my Oma primarily grew up. She spoke Dutch as her first language and traveled to Holland for school before officially sailing her land in the United States. When 12th grade rolled around, I immediately knew this was going to be my senior project, writing the biography of my Oma. After getting my Oma's stamp of approval, I asked Maria Fitzgerald to be my mentor. She's from Honduras and taught Spanish here when I was in middle school. She couldn't be here for my speech today, so she's in California right now on her book tour for her debut middle grade novel, Turtles of the Midnight Moon. To repeat, she's officially a published author, and everyone should go read her book. She's amazing. Anyways, I was ready to start my project last May, which I split into three different phases. The first, listening and outlining. The second, writing and research. And the third, designing and formatting. I wanted to start as early as possible because I knew that my senior year would be nothing short of busy and stressful. So, in the summer, I knocked out pretty much the entire first phase of my plan. I basically just listened to my Oma. She told me stories about her life. She told me about how her grandfather survived World War II, how she ran around with her cousins in the rainforest of Suriname, beauty school in Holland, and her immigration to the U.S., among so many other stories. I didn't trust myself to remember anything, so I decided to record all her stories, as well as take rough notes on my computer. It was great, just spending time with my Oma. It was like when I was little again.
Aww.
So here's a little excerpt from one of the favorite stories she told me. It's called Nawari. It's one of the most memorable stories that my Oma told me about Suriname when I was young. And it was the first thing we talked about recordings and the first story I wrote on paper. It's a little graphic, but I think it's really important. When my Oma was about 13 years old, she had a chicken coop in her backyard. In Paramaribo, the capital city of Suriname, Ashu, her grandfather, owned an import-export business and would go to the harbor frequently to check for freights. On one of those visits, he'd come across an abandoned bucket filled to the brim with chicks. Ashu brought the chicks to her house, hiring carpenters to construct and build a giant chicken coop on the large property. At that time, my Oma lived outside the city in Lidithora, a more rural area. Sufo, her father, hated the noise of the city, fearing the solitude of the rainforest. The property was enormous, with enough acres that my Oma doesn't remember the number. There were more than enough space to build a chicken coop next to the rows of ripe fruit ready to fall from the nest of leaves. My Oma remembers the trees on the property most vividly, the overbearing smell of citrus from crowded orange trees, and the flushed red of the ripe mango nestled among the fronds. Spiky jackfruit, larger than imaginable, weighed down white speckled branches, and bunches of bananas blossomed outwards to search for sunlight. But it was the avocado trees that my Oma loved the most, especially when she wanted a snack. When I was younger, she split a ripe avocado in half, sprinkling sea salt over each bite. We'd sit together at the table and dig out the flesh with a spoon. This is how we used to eat them in Suriname, my Oma would tell me, but we would take them straight from the tree. Soon enough, Ashley's chicks were to become chickens, and my oma's family had fresh eggs every day. It was more than the family could eat. My oma ate two to three herself every day, and they ended up giving eggs away to all their neighbors and practically anyone who wanted them. One fateful night, around 10 or 11 o'clock, ear-curling screams rang out from the coop, which sprung my oma out of bed. Her father called her downstairs to help investigate the frenzied chickens, or rather, what had caused them to scream bloody murder. Zuko armed himself with a machete, while my oma wielded a pitchfork. I was the brave one, she told me, with a mixture of pride and laughter. In the dark of the night, they headed out to the chicken coop. My oma kept guard outside the door while her father crept into the henhouse. The culprit of the chicken coop was what my oma refers to as an owari. Although Dutch, the official language of Suriname, the country was once a former colony of the Netherlands, many of the languages spoke a Creole language called Serrano, which goes by a variety of different names. My oma knew it as Taki Taki. Owari was the word that the Surinamese used to name the pesky, vicious little creatures that would run around the night and rummage through garbage. They are most notoriously known for infiltrating chicken coops. In the English language, we know them as opossums. As soon as her father went into the henhouse and people cheered her, a single owari leaped out. It jumped onto the wire walls of the coop, scrambling to climb away. My oma waved her pitchfork to try and knock down the fence. One of the prongs stabbed the owari, and it fell to the ground writhing, leaving a deep gash along my oma's arm with its sharp claws. As the creature hit the ground, it lay moving in the darkness. In the end, Sufo was proud of my oma for her bravery, although she does still complain he didn't do a thing to help her out the night. None of the grown chickens were hurt. Owari tend to go after smaller targets, and chickens are too big for their taste. The eggs, however, were a different story. The owari splattered them all over the coop, which had riled up the chickens into a frenzy, screaming and flying around in the middle of the night. One of the family's caretakers of the land buried the dead in the morning. And despite my oma's fear and guilt over the startling experience, she found it to be an adventure. Once I gathered a general summary of information about my oma's life, I was able to pick out individual stories I wanted to highlight, as well as create a mental timeline to map it all out. I decided to designate a chapter for each place she lived, along with a prologue on her family history and a concluding section that will be my point of view for the present. So now, it was time to start writing. So to start, I got all of my recordings and decided to transcribe them directly to their person on paper, so I'd have something to work with. This was a tedious process. To explain, these are all the recordings I have. Good amount, from all from various times. This is the length of them all added together. And furthermore, it doesn't just take 3 hours, 24 minutes, and 46 seconds to write this all down. It was a constant battle of listening for a few seconds, stopping, writing a couple more seconds, getting confused, going back 3 seconds to clarify my thoughts, realizing that this wasn't in chronological order, hearing my dog barking in the background recording, just drowning out my oma's voice, and repeating this whole process again, if you want to get an idea of what it's like. But I got it done. And once I had this foundation, I began incorporating more detail and my own voice through my words. Another thing that was really important to me was that I really wanted to provide historical context to my oma's life and stories through research. When I tell people my oma grew up in Suriname, 90% of the time, they don't know what Suriname is. Suriname is a small country on the northern coast of South America with a diverse ethnic composition. The country is fairly impoverished due to its repeated history of colonization from different European nations. Few people know that Suriname is one of 4 countries in South America that does not speak Spanish, and is the only country in South America that has an official language of Dutch. There's so much history that no one teaches us about. Many people don't know about the dark history of Asian indentured servitude, which is how my great-great-grandfather got to Suriname in the first place, to work on a sugarcane plantation. Here's a quick excerpt about that. Ashu came from China to Suriname with his 2 older brothers at the turn of the 20th century. After most countries in the Americas had emancipated slavery, certain governments and companies would contract and import Asian immigrants, specifically the Chinese, to work as indentured servants. Latin America was flooded with hundreds of thousands of Chinese workers across numerous countries. It's not just history that isn't discussed enough. There are also issues that are so relevant today. There's a huge under-identification of Asian Americans diagnosed with disabilities and disorders. The Hmong minority myth is rooted so deeply in our society that it infiltrates Asian American communities as well. I wanted this book to not only capture my oma's life, but capture a lot of unknown history behind every decision she and her family made. So I did a lot of research and incorporated the necessary points in my story. Phase 2 was a long process. Writing and researching was the bulk of this whole project. I frequented so many cafes. I shone, do my workout for hours, and tried a lot of drinks during the process. If anybody needs any recommendations for cafes in the New York, New Jersey area, I got you. My mentor helped me edit and revise sections along the way, and my mom helped me make sure everything flowed smoothly and accurately. And finally, I had a carefully crafted manuscript that was ready for phase three, designing and formatting. Now, writing is a passion of mine, and I've been a writer since I was a little kid. Designing and formatting, something I had little experience with, and I greatly overestimated my abilities. My goal for the end of the project was to have a physical book of all my work, although I prioritized the actual writing and content of the book. I began to research websites where you could self-publish a hard copy without them being $100 per copy or having to purchase $800 minimum. I settled on a website called Lulu, which met my criteria the best. So after finishing my manuscript in late February, I barely had a month to complete the entirety of designing and formatting. This was brutal. Now, to print a book, you have to have certain margins, pick your fonts, check your page breaks, basically structure the entirety of your manuscript into what it will look like printed. It sounded super daunting to me, so I tried to find on my website that would automatically do it. And I thought I hit the jackpot when I found a website that would format my book for me. I would just have to insert my manuscript, and when I was ready, I'd hit the convert button. Only to find out that the free conversion was only an EPUB setup, like for ebooks. To convert into a Word document, which was the format I needed, I would have to pay $295. Yeah, but it was okay. I found a way around it. I could convert a test version to Word for free. The problem was that because it was a test version, it would randomly scramble and move like two or three words per paragraph. So I'd have to manually go through 66 pages of text and unscramble every single word. My mom found me an hour into this tedious process, and it showed me how to format a document in Microsoft Word. I am embarrassed to say that formatting took literally 10 minutes to do in Word, and my mother was once again right as usual. My mentor also gave me the idea to include a family tree at the beginning of the book for readers to hypothetically refer back to if they got confused by names or anything. I agreed and decided to try my hand at graphic design. The next step was the book cover. I thought about what kind of book cover I wanted since I started this project. I thought about some kind of old picture to use for the cover, preferably one showing the landscape of Suriname, since that chapter was the most impactful of the entire book. I collected dozens of old photos of my Oma and my family when she was young. My mentor and I had considered putting a glossy section in the visible book for all these photos to be displayed. But Lulu, among other publishing websites I found, didn't really have an option to include pages and images that are high quality among my texts, without it being ridiculously expensive. So, I got creative. I scanned and printed all the pictures I wanted to use to create a collage out of them. This way, I could still include all the pictures I had without having to deal with the extra hassle of formatting them into my manuscript. And this is the final product. I was very proud of myself. I wanted to do a hardcover book, so I imported this all. I imported this all to Canva to create a nice background for where the edges of the cover wraps around the book, and to create a back cover. I thought it would be cute to include some photos of my own mom with me and my brother when we were young and back, along with a few graphics. And so this is the printed version. It's a little crooked, but it's fine. So. I chose my title last because, I forgot about the most obvious detail until the very end. I didn't really have an idea until I read the opening paragraph of the manuscript, which sparked the idea of this. Sorry, it's right now. I'm straight from the book. My Oma has hands that look like tree roots, green and protruding. My first memories of her sitting next to me, peeling mandarins, the throbbing veins of her hands twisting and turning. Once the peel is removed, she'd take off that thin layer of skin around the meat of the fruit, the part that is usually just swallowed. She's meticulous with her arthritis on her fingers and long fingernails. She wouldn't let me eat until all of it was removed. She would tell me of her home country, Suriname, using a variety of words in Dutch, Cantonese, Hakka, Taki Taki, and English. My mouth would be parched. She'd quench my thirst with a fresh slice of mandarin. Today, I am old enough to peel and cut my own fruit, but I'm still my Oma's only granddaughter, and I still enjoy her stories about her life. Moon festivals with her grandfather in Hong Kong, climbing mango trees with her cousins in Suriname, living with nuns in the Netherlands, and navigating a new life in the United States. It felt right to immortalize the stories on paper, preserving every unique and captivating memory of my own. some of my own hands as tree roots and various pieces of work, because I always thought it was beautiful. And it seemed fitting to make that the title, since I was talking about the roots of our family history. I officially published and ordered my book on March 20th at 2:43 a.m. This book was literally my baby. Finishing it was the best feeling ever. If there's anything I can tell you I learned from this project, is that everyone has stories. So don't be afraid to listen and ask questions, especially if it's to a loved one. The best storytellers can make even the most mundane of stories to something captivating and life-changing. You can learn a lot of things from people, but only if you start listening. There are a lot of people I have to thank for making this project possible. First is my family and family friends, from those who live in my household to those still living in Holland today. Between translation, support, and encouragement, I could not have done it without them. And that's thank you to my mom for sparking the idea in the first place. Spending the time to look over and editing my manuscript, as well as dealing with my complaining. I'd like to thank my mentor, Maria, for helping me bring my vision to life. My in-school mentor, Ms. Caldwell, for keeping me on track among the chaos, and Ms. Montagnoli for all their rehearsing prep. Thank you to my class, who have always encouraged me and provided much-needed laughter whenever I felt stressed. And of course, a biggest thank you to my Oma, who is my inspiration and my idol. I'm so proud of all your strength and their bravery. I hope that others now have an idea of your incredible character. I love you very much. And lastly, thank you so much to everyone here for taking the time to listen to me. So she really wanted this project to be about her good memories, her happy memories in her childhood, you know, playing with her cousins, going out to buy dresses with her grandfather in Hong Kong. So she didn't really want it to even involve bad memories, which I do, and I did end up including in my book, because I think that's what makes her so strong, and that's what makes the good memories so powerful. Right. And just being able to hold on to those, and I did write that into the book in like the last parts, but basically being able to hold on to these good memories, like this light in her life, let her survive in the darkest days. And I think that was really important.
And will the book be for sale?
I was thinking about that. I definitely want to do a little more edits because I would want a time crunch. So I was like thinking about it, but it's fine. But I was thinking about selling a version of it. I work for AADI, which stands for a nonprofit, which is Asian American Disability Initiative. I was thinking of doing it as a fundraiser for them, something like that. That's up in the air. But one of my classmates gave me the idea for a pre-order form. So I would love to in the future, but we'll see.
Do you think you can write more books?
I hope so. If it works out.
Sorry. Is there anything that your alma told you about that now that you're thinking the story's over that you really want to go do or see or experience for yourself, or someone you would want to meet?
I would love to go to Sarah someday and just kind of like see where she grew up, because she thinks fondly of it a lot. Who I want to meet? I don't know. I think her cousins would be fun. I think they're still kind of scattered around today. I think a lot of them are still in Holland. But I don't know. I'd be curious to like kind of see like from a different point of view, like how like they perceive my alma. I think it'd be very interesting.
What do you do when you have writer's block?
Okay. So this project was actually really easy when I had writer's block, because I like had material all laid out before me. So I didn't really have much writer's block. I did have trouble though with kind of trying to transform the words into like my own, because you know this is my own telling me this in first person. So I really wanted to add my own voice. I wanted to add descriptions. So that's where kind of the research came in. That's where I kind of linked back to my own memories in certain parts. Like, so that's kind of what I tried to do. So it would be also my story.
One more question.
Yeah.
What is the biggest lesson you learned from your grandmother as a result of writing this book?
Biggest lesson. I wrote this in some of my dedication kind of for it's kind of a feeling one, but to just hold on to like the good memories, like hold on to the light. And just, there's a lot of stories about how strong the women, especially in my family, are and how much they went through. And that part I also really enjoyed. I think that really transcends, and I'm very proud of the women in my family.
Good evening, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Zoe, and I'm going to be talking about my path to dressage, as well as my experience learning, choreographing, and filming a dressage freestyle video. The most common thing you hear when talking about dressage is, oh, is that the type of riding where the horses are dancing? And the answer is yes, kind of. In my mentor's words, dressage is the most elevated form of flat work, created to enhance your horse's gait, or movement. Each movement demonstrates the horse's specific strengths, such as power, suppleness, collection, extension, athleticism, etc. In other words, dressage is really a horse's version of ballet. To be honest, before I started doing dressage, I always thought it was a bit boring to watch, but now that I understand it, I find it fascinating. Because I was once in your shoes of not really knowing what it was or what I was looking at, I will try to make this as interesting as possible. Horses have been a constant part of my life for the past 12 years, after I started riding through Green Meadow's school program when I was 7 years old. I don't really remember why I started riding in the first place, but looking back, I cannot help but be thankful for my parents telling me to think about it before deciding to stop after the first semester. On winter break that year, I said I thought horses were cool, but that I didn't think I wanted to continue riding. And then, in the 2 weeks we had off that year, I couldn't shut up about horses. It's safe to say I had caught the horse bug, and once you have that, good luck. I rode with Green Meadows school program for about 4 or 5 years before I started taking private lessons somewhere else. I bounced around a little bit after that until I ended up at a barn where I was able to start competing in local shows, jumping cross rails and 2 foot jumps in both the hunter and equitation divisions. Hunters is basically where the horse is judged on how they perform, and equitation is more focused on how the rider looks. In eighth grade, I moved barns again and found my way to the jumpers, my happy place. For most parents, their kid telling them they wanted to try the jumpers is probably a nightmare, because the goal of jumpers is basically to jump a course of jumps as fast as you can with it while staying within a time limit and not knocking anything down. My parents, however, were very supportive, and I was lucky enough to have an amazing competition year in 2021. When the time to make a decision about my senior project rolled around, I was not riding due to medical reasons, but I still really wanted to do something with horses. And that idea led me to dressage, something that was still on horseback, but that was completely different than any other type of riding I had previously done. I reached out to Annie McPhee, Miss Holly's daughter, and a Green Meadow alum, the only person I knew in the dressage world, and she put me in contact with my amazing mentor, Cameron Banks, who happens to be teaching in Bergen County, New Jersey. My first two lessons were interesting, to say the least, and extremely eye-opening. I had not been on a horse in almost 5 months, and I had never ridden a properly trained dressage horse ever in my life, so I was in for a big surprise when I squeezed my legs to get him to walk forward, and I was informed that squeezing a dressage horse will make them collect themselves, but not move forward at all. My first lesson went relatively well, all things considered, but I was so sore that entire week after that I could barely walk normally while we were in Hermit Island. My second lesson did not go as well as the first, mostly because that horse and I were not a great match. So after that, Cameron and I ended up working out of a different barn that had a horse I could ride, named Ares. In my lessons over the past 5 months, I worked on learning the fundamentals of dressage, as well as some higher level movements. The main things I had to figure out first were the different body positions I needed to be in, leaning much further back than I was used to, and sitting deep into the saddle, as well as keeping my elbows pinned to my sides and preventing myself from squeezing my legs. The last two were more difficult to change than expected, and the elbows at my sides is still a work in progress, but after having to ride with pool reins between my elbows and torso, I can definitely say that I am improving. In dressage, the rider's aids, which are instructions to the horse, should be subtle, if visible at all, telling the horse exactly what you want them to do by merely the location of your foot on their side, the direction your shoulders are pointing, and extremely importantly, the way you're sitting in the saddle. Most movements in dressage happen at either the walk, trot, or canter. Each gait has the basic collection and extension, as well as different types of lateral movements, which I will be demonstrating in a moment. For my senior project, I worked on collection and extension, which is the floaty-looking movement, and I was also able to successfully learn some of the more complicated lateral movements. In my freestyle presentation, I have shoulder ins, which put the horse's inside shoulder off the rail and their back inside leg in line with their front outside leg, creating three tracks or visible legs from the front. To ask for this, you keep your hips positioned forward in line with the wall. You shift your hands to the inside of the neck. You turn your shoulders to the opposite corner. You keep your head looking forward, and you use your inside leg to keep their back end on the rail. I also learned the half pass, which is a sideways and diagonal movement where the horse's head is turned slightly in the direction you are moving, and their back outside leg crosses under them to propel them sideways while still moving forward. The rider position for the half pass is the same as the shoulder in, however, you have to bend the horse's head and use your other leg to push them sideways. I also learned leg yields, which are similar to half passes, except the horse's head is bent slightly away from the direction you're moving. All of the movements I demonstrated can be done at the walk, trot, and canter. However, I only demonstrate them at the trot in my freestyle video. In the canter, I do flying lead changes, which, when done consecutively, look like the horse is skipping. A flying lead change is done in one stride when the horse shifts both of their legs at the same time, landing with the opposite leg forward than when they started. To ask for this, you just swing your outside leg back a few inches on their side. I know it's not easy to imagine the movements based on the description, but you will see them all in my video at the end. In dressage, there are tests and freestyles. Tests have a specific pattern designed to show certain movements in a very prescribed way, and they are judged based on the execution of the movement. Freestyles are, as it sounds, much more free. They are choreographed with music and are really up to the rider to decide. There are required movements that need to be incorporated, but for the most part, there's a lot more creative freedom. Dressage freestyles are judged on technical execution as well as creative execution. For my senior project, I created a list of skills I wanted to learn, and then in my lessons on Aries, once or twice a week, we worked on learning what was on that list. In late January, February, and March, I drove to Pennsylvania on Sundays to work with Cameron on her horse, Jazzy, who I was lucky enough to film on. Jazzy is about as professional and fancy as they get. And my first few times riding him, I felt like I had been dropped in a video game on level 300 when I was still on level 5. I really had no idea what I was doing on him, but I was able to pull the choreography together in only 7 lessons with Jazzy. Traditional dressage freestyles usually use instrumental or classical music, but because it was a senior project, we had a lot of fun with it and chose to use the Top Gun soundtrack. The freestyle was filmed from 3 different angles, which you might be able to see, and if you look close enough, you can see Jazzy's breath, because it was only 28 degrees on film day. Now that you're familiar with some of the movements, this slide shows all of my choreography in 6 different images, so that they do not overlap. So, starting where it is now, that sideways arrows are half passes, across is usually extended, trot, the purple is a walk. The circle in the corner is a trot, sideways is another half pass. Down the wall there is a shoulder in, into a half pass, into a trot, down to a walk, and into a canter, circle, lead change, back to the trot, and then here I do the zigzag is done in with leg yields, and so you may see me sort of shifting side to side. Yeah, and without further ado, here is my video.
Thank you.
people that helped make this project what it is. But first and foremost, I want to thank my amazing mentor, Cameron Banks, who could not be here tonight, for jumping in feet first and helping me accomplish my crazy dream in a very short amount of time, and especially for trusting me to ride her horse, Jazzy. I want to thank Lexi and Giovanni from Rebellious Stables for being welcoming and helpful and for letting me ride Aries. Annie McPhee for connecting me with my mentor and for always being there to answer any questions I have. My parents and sister for all of their support and for going with me on many very early Sunday mornings to Pennsylvania and back. I also want to thank Noah Graham for helping with the video. It would not be what it is without his help. My in-school mentor, Mick Stern, for helping me with my presentation and for keeping me on track through the craziness of senior year. My class for always being there and for putting up with Top Gun music playing on repeat. Some of them have funny stories of me learning my choreography in the common room during the study hall. I'm pretty sure there are videos of that somewhere. And last but not least, I want to thank Aries and Jazzy. This project truly would not have been possible without them. Thank you. Each level sort of has its own set of skills that go with it. Some of the moves I were doing were around level 3. My mentor is about level 8. And yes, it is competitive, and I do not myself see myself competing, mostly because I love jumpers, and we'll probably switch back to that. But yes, it is a competitive sport. Yes.
Sorry, I have two questions. First, what does it mean for a horse to collect itself? And what are some of the factors that would make a horse and a rider a good fit or a bad fit?
Okay, so collection is basically when the horse sort of, the way it was described to me is they kind of package themselves, but you see it's often a much smaller stride with more power from the back, so they're like sitting back a little bit more, and it's still the same amount of power, but usually the strides are a bit shorter. And good match or not so great match, in my case, the horse was not willing to work, and so he wouldn't move, and then when he would move, it was backwards or up in the air. So that wasn't really a productive situation. Yeah, so that in my case, that was why that one didn't work out. Yes.
So in watching Jazzy's feet, he was like truly right with the beat on all four of the selections from the soundtrack. How do you control that from the saddle?
So, normally when you do freestyle, you ride with the music, and in my lessons, I did ride with music. When we filmed, there were so many moving parts that we ended up adding the music later, and so that was some really great editing that got me beat. But normally, when you ride, it's sort of up to the rider to moderate the pace and really keep it in beat. I guess what I'm saying. Yeah.
Ms. Caldwell. What have you gotten out of riding all these years?
I would say for me it's been a really positive thing. I've been able to kind of get out of whatever's going on in my head. So for me, whenever I'm on a horse or at the barn, I'm not really thinking about what else is going on in my life or all the list of things I have to do. And when I'm riding, it's really just you have to be very focused and very in the moment. And I really love that. And then also they're like a mini therapy session when you're with them. So I really, they're fun to be around when they're friendly. Yes.
How much preparation before, so you come out of the stall with Jazzy or Fairings and how much warm-up time, that's the right word I wanted to use, how much warm-up time is there prior to starting, in this case, the filming of the actual, orchestration, or the choreography,
yeah.
Right?
So normally, between the time you take them out of the stall and you get on is usually about half an hour of grooming and tacking. warming up like 15 minutes. The day I filmed, it was really, really cold. We filmed at, we had to get to the barn at 7:30 in the morning, and it was below freezing, so my mentor got on and warmed him up, and then I got on, so he had probably been ridden for about 40 minutes before we filmed.
And then is there a cool down period? I'm just thinking about like when we exercise, like when humans exercise, there's the warm up and then there's the exercise and then there's the cool down. And just think about the time that you've invested. So
yeah, so to cool down, depending on how sweaty they get, in the winter we ride often with what's called a quarter sheet. So it's like it's a blanket that goes on their like the back end. And sometimes they can get really sweaty under there. And so usually you walk out until they're not like sweaty to the touch. And then it's lots and lots of hurrying and brushing. As far as like how long you should plan to be at the barn, for me it was usually like a good solid like 3.5-4 hours.
Did this technique give you a new appreciation for horses?
It did, yes. It definitely gave me a new appreciation for dressage. I mentioned in the beginning, I always thought it was kind of boring, and watching it, I was like, I just didn't understand why their feet were moving, because how I had been taught to ride the entire time, your legs are not supposed to move. And I didn't realize that that was actually purposeful. I would say, as far as horses, it's really incredible that they actually do what we ask of them and kind of tell them to do. I had an incident where it didn't, what I was saying wasn't happening, and that's not such a great feeling, but I have just a lot of respect for them for even listening to us. So, yeah. Yes.
When tackling the new form of riding, did you have any safety concerns?
I did not really have any safety concerns, aside from the one moment I mentioned. I had, there was an incident with Aries, who I was riding, and that it rattled me a little bit, and it took a little bit to come back from that. I did not fall off. As far as me, I have fallen off in the future, so my back is like normal to have problems. Physical therapy is very helpful for that. But I didn't have any major safety concerns, mostly because I'm used to jumping, and so this was just like flat. So it was, yeah, a little easier actually. Yes.
One of the things I love that you said is that Jazzy's a professional. And I'm just curious, can you elaborate a little bit more, as someone who's never ridden, I understand what you're saying, but what is it like to ride a horse that's a professional and fancy, above the description, right, versus a horse that's not?
Yeah, so the biggest thing is, I am very new to dressage, and so me sort of figuring out how to ask for certain things was sort of a challenge, and I really had to figure that out. And so when I got on him, it would be, because he's so finely tuned to my mentor who owns him and has been training him for the past 6 years, that, you know, she could barely think something and he'll know what she wants. And so for me, it was sort of like, I kind of had to figure out what exactly he wanted. And he was kind of like, I think in the beginning, because I only rode him 7 times. And so it was sort of, I would move my leg to ask for something and he was like, just didn't understand what I was saying because I wasn't being quite clear enough. And so when they just know so much, you have to be extremely specific because they have so many different buttons and gears. And from someone who didn't really know all of them, that's kind of why I felt like I was like, ooh, don't really know what's going on here. But yeah, so I was able to figure it out, but it took a little bit of time. Yeah. Yes, Mrs. Dan.
Is there a certain breed of horse that is more suited to dressage, and what breed is Jazzy?
Jazzy is a German sport horse. He's 12 years old, I believe. And as far as breeds, I think it really depends more on the way the horse is built, because I think you can't really say one breed, they'll all be able to do it. Some horses are really not very coordinated, and in dressage you have to be able to like cross your legs and be okay with that, and not fall over or trip constantly. As far as breeds, a lot of times, I'm not entirely sure which breed specifically. I think a lot of the European warmbloods and sort of like sport horse type ones, the more finely boned horses tend to do a little better because they're not quite so clunky. But
how big was he?
He is 17'2". For reference, my mentor is 6 foot. I'm 5'1". And so my little legs were a bit of an adjustment for him, I think. But, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions? Okay.
She's also spreading knowledge, teaching others how to make a pillow that brings breast cancer patients comfort in the car.
We're not just making them, we're filling them with love, and that is what that hug is. It's just spreading that love to as many people as possible.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Charlotte Abrams, and I'm really excited to share my project with you today. Growing up at Green Meadow, I always wondered what my senior project would be. Perhaps I would do self-defense, or maybe I would finally learn how to be coordinated enough to dance. But ultimately, my project was entirely different. I decided to use this time to work on my POSH pillow project, POSH being an acronym for Post-Op Supported Hug. The purpose of the project is to make and teach other people how to make mastectomy pillows for patients recovering from breast cancer-related surgeries, and then these pillows are donated to different locations. How the POSH pillow works, it serves as a protective barrier between the seatbelt and the surgical site so that patients can travel more comfortably in the car. The reason that I started this project is because recently someone close to me underwent breast cancer-related surgeries, and as a result, I witnessed her discomfort when traveling in the car. And seeing this, I wanted to make a difference. I wanted to aid her in her recovery. And so I hurried down to my basement, and I created the first POSH pillow. And after seeing how she benefited from this, I wanted to make POSH pillows available to everyone. This summer, I did a lot of the foundational work on my project, including my social media. I made an Instagram, a Facebook, and I also created a GoFundMe to support my project. Additionally, I developed a website that includes information about the project, ways to help, and it also has my POSH pillow pattern, because not only do I want the POSH pillows themselves to be available to everyone, but I want the pattern to be available so that people can make these pillows from the comfort of their own home. Finally, I have a tab that includes updates about upcoming events and news. This summer, I also developed my pattern, which took a lot of time because I really wanted to create a pillow that had both form and function. And there are other mastectomy pillows that exist, but the issue is they're just made for function and they're quite uncomfortable, and I didn't want that. So I spent a lot of time working on the armholes and the different measurements so that the pillow would be most comfortable and also not shift when in the car. This is the pattern that I have on my website that anyone can download. As of right now, I use a cardboard stencil that I created. My hope is to have a plastic stencil in the future. Not only did making the pattern take time, but I also had to make the actual pillow. And it took a few iterations before I had the final product that is here today. This is almost a step-by-step of that process, making the pattern, sewing it, and then the final product. And quick story, I was sewing one day and I accidentally sewed my sweatshirt right in with the pillow. I knew I was attached to my project, but not like that. Now, again, I don't only make the pillows, but I also teach them to other people. And so for these events, I need to prepare in different ways, one of which is marketing. I go around to different towns, and I hang up flyers, and I also post on my social media so that people are aware of my events. Additionally, I need to buy the materials for the events, which is a very specific process. I wanted to use fabrics that weren't too dark, but also not too overwhelming. And so I've settled with colors such as blue, purple, yellow, some turquoise. But I really wanted to make sure that they were positive colors, but still not drawing unwanted attention. I've had 4 official events so far, and I've also taught a class here at Green Meadow to the 9th graders. And what I find is that at every event, I learn something new, whether it's a new way, a new technique for the POSH pillows, or even a new way to teach it, because of course this project isn't just sewing a pillow. There's also an educational aspect. What I love about these events is that everyone is there out of the kindness of their own heart, and each pillow is made with so much care and love that you know that the people receiving that can feel that supportive hug, all that love that's there. And I think that is so beautiful and touching, truly.
The Posh Pillow Project has been featured in magazines and newspapers, both digitally and in print. And I also have received recognition from different political leaders for my project, including Congressman Gottheimer, Senator Shapizi, and Assemblywoman DeFusio. And for these awards, not only am I so appreciative, but also so humbled and honored, truly. So I want to say thank you for that. What is the outreach of this project? As of right now, I have sent Posh Pillows to 5 different states, and I will be going to Argentina for the next 3 weeks to teach students there how to make Posh Pillows. So there will now be Posh Pillows in 5 different states and 2 different countries, with many more to come. What is the future of this project? Well, I've been working with the Girl Scouts. I actually just had an event with them back in February, and I will be having another event with them in May. And we're looking for ways to integrate this into maybe even being a badge for them. This would mean that Girl Scouts all across the country would be making pillows and donating them to local places. Oh, I'm sorry. I meant to also add that I want to include a locations feature on my website, where you can type in your location, your address, and it will tell you where all the nearby pillows are for you to pick up. I have many thank yous because I received a lot of support for this project. I want to start with my wonderful family. Growing up in such an encouraging, loving, and supportive environment has made me feel like I can reach for the highest stars. And in that way, this project has been able to grow so much, and so I am so grateful for that. I also want to say thank you to my sister, Maddie, who cannot be here today, but she is incredibly supportive, so positive, always has been there for me, and her love is just unconditional, and I'm so, so lucky to have her. I want to say thank you to my out-of-school mentor, Mix Boynton, who helped me consider how I wanted to do my pattern and also worked with me on this educational side of the project, different teaching methods. I want to thank all the Green Meadow faculty who helped me with this project, whether it's with this presentation or even just imagining how the Posh Pillow Project could be integrated into Green Meadow. I want to give a special shout out to Alex and Rayon, who have helped me buy materials and also came to my first event here downstate, and Rayon for helping me with the 9th grade event. Speaking of which, I want to thank the 9th graders for the enthusiasm that they brought to this project, and I am so grateful to have this opportunity to share it with them. I want to thank my supportive classmates for always having such a positive energy and for just being incredible. Not only did Alex and Ryan come to that event, but as did Aiden, Krishna, Jasper, Nathan, Billy virtually, and Marcella have helped me with my 9th grade event. And so I want to give you all a special thank you for showing up, for really being there for this project, because you are what is helping it grow. So thank you. And finally, I want to say thank you to everyone who has supported this project, whether it's through my GoFundMe, by following my social media, or even just being here today. It makes the difference, so thank you. I want to end by saying that I have brought some Posh Pillows here today, so if any of you have someone in mind that you would like to give one to, I'm happy to meet with you after the presentations are over to give you one. Thank you.
What was the moment for you where you sat back and said to yourself, you know what, it was all worth it?
I don't think there was a moment I didn't think it was worth it, is the truth. I never was frustrated, like I never wanted to give up with what I was doing. I always felt really good about it. I think that there were moments where I considered maybe I needed to do something differently, but there was never really a moment where I was feeling negative about the project. Other questions?
How washable are these pillows?
I would say relatively washable. It's been washed before, and it's been okay. The one thing I would say is that the stuffing inside might take longer to dry. So that was the only thing that I've been considering, and I'm working with different ideas of waterproof fabrics, or even actually, I was talking to someone possibly about having pockets for ice packs for people who have had lumpectomies, but the issue is waterproofing it. But for the most part, they are washable. Yes. Personally or in general, how many? In general. Well, as far as I know, about 100 pillows so far have been made, but those are the ones from events or the ones I've made myself. But of course, the pattern is online as well. So there are many pillows that have been made that I'm not even sure about, but around 100. Other questions?
Yeah. You have a pattern online, but have you ever thought of actually, you know, making them and shaping them to people who maybe don't have access to sewing machines?
Yes. So actually, one thing I was thinking of doing is making a posh pillow kit. The issue is that this project is based fully on donations. So to do that, I need to think of different ways to bring in money so that I can afford the kits and afford to provide all the materials for my events and provide these pillows free of charge. But it is a thought.
Follow-up.
Yes.
If people wanted to donate, would you choose to start a donation unless they donate?
On my website, I can direct you, I'm not going to show it here, but there's a place that says Ways to Help. And you can click on that and it will take you right to a link that brings you directly to my GoFundMe. I also have it on my Instagram, so it's another way to find it. And thank you. Thank you.
Have you received any feedback or messages of gratitude from patients who have benefited from your pillows?
I have, and I actually appreciate the opportunity to talk with people who are receiving them because I learn more about how people are benefiting them from them, but I also hear people's stories, which I think is important, that I'm not just separated from those who are receiving these pillows. But yes, I have been in communication. Some people, I even check in with them because they'll tell me when they're having their surgery, and I will check in with them periodically to see how they're doing and let them know I'm thinking of them. Any other questions? Bill?
Have you found integrating these into hospitals so that patients can have them directly after?
It's a great question. I have been talking to a few hospitals, and the issue is that some cannot take something that's not necessarily like certified medical. But I have been working with other centers, so I actually just sent 18 pillows to a cancer center out in Missouri. So I am working with different hospitals. Some accept them and some don't. Next thing.
I guess I'm wondering if you're also finding that you're raising awareness about breast cancer, like for instance working with the Girl Scouts, or what kind of questions, or what does that look like, I guess?
Do you mean what kind of questions I receive?
Yeah, yes. Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people aren't aware that breast cancer affects all people, that it's not just on women. And I had an interesting conversation with the ninth graders about that the other day, actually. And the younger kids don't ask many questions. I don't think that they're fully aware of exactly what this means. But other people do, and it's an interesting conversation, and sometimes I even have questions because I'm still learning. What I do, though, is I'm working with an organization called Charcherit, and they provide me materials to give out to people as well, so that if they have questions that they don't think of in that moment, they have resources they can call or anything they can look up.
Did you document your journey, this process? And I'm wondering if, like, this process with this project, is it similar for other projects? Like, is it kind of like the foundation of what to do, when to do, who to reach out to for other projects?
I think mine might have been a little bit different, but I did structure it. I knew that there were things that I needed to do in advance before I could branch out. So that's what that summer was. It was just getting that website done. I needed to do all the heavy lifting early so that I could do the next steps later. But in terms of a general structure of, okay, I need to do this, and then my next step will be, I don't know, making the pattern, yes. But then once all of that foundation was laid out, I need to just contact someone and find different dates I'm available and set up different calls. But it wasn't like a step-by-step process necessarily. I just knew that that was what I needed.
Have you figured out how much one pillow costs you to make?
That is a really good question. And I'm actually not entirely sure, and the reason for that is each pillow, if you go to Joanne Fabrics and you get a yard of fabric, you can get two pillows from that. And so what I often do is I just know that I have about 40. Last event I had 70 people attend. So sometimes it's a little bit uneven, so I'm not always sure. But I know about how many pillows I need to make. I get that much material, and I also have thread that I buy in advance and things like that, so I'm not entirely certain. But that's actually something I should look into. Any other questions?
Have you found that this project has helped you expand on your business skills and learning about the business side of creating something and getting it out to the public?
Absolutely. I think that actually something I really struggle with is the social media aspect, because I always say I need to post this and I always forget. But something I've also had to keep in mind is confidentiality, privacy of people. I'm taking pictures at events, but I can't show these young children's faces on my Instagram without their permission. So that is something I never really thought I would have, never thought about, because why would I need to until this project? I think also learning how to speak about it in front of other people, so like today, but also at different events, and knowing how to market myself. I'm not always that good at talking about myself, but I needed to learn how to say, this is what I've done, and this is what you can do, and how you can be a part of it. And so definitely, I think so. Any other questions?
You mentioned the ice packs. Are you planning on offering any other customizations, different armhole sizes, levels of padding, that sort of thing?
In terms of the armhole, what I found is I designed it actually so that it can fit almost every arm size, because I can actually show you this. The idea is that your arm doesn't necessarily go through, but it kind of sits in it. So, and I created it so that your arm can fall into the space here. So I would say it's pretty general in that sense. In terms of patterns, I mean, if someone wanted to email me and get a specific pattern, I could go and look for it. But as of right now, I just buy a lot of certain colors, and I just go from there. I do have two sizes of the pillows. So I have, this is a small medium, and then I have a large extra large. But generally, I think the size works for most people. Thank you. Hello, my name is Jasmine Krivostova, and this is my first song, Saint. Oh.
is Her, and I'm going to be having Marcella accompany me for this. She's going to be singing the harmonies that I have in my recording that I did myself.
Her in the corner, always taking her time. Her in the mirror, always changing her mind. Who knows who she is and what she wants? Has her own idea of who we are. She who knows all her emotions, the rest of us wish that we knew what we wouldn't do.
Thank you so much. So, good evening. My name is Jasmine Srivastava, as I said, and I've decided to make an EP for my senior project, which is essentially a shortened version of an album. So my EP includes three songs, for which I wrote the lyrics and the melodies to. The first track, Sane, that you listen to, is about finding the beauty in the present moment, especially for me, kind of during this time of change and unknown as I go to college. I really wanted the song to be a reminder that if you stay in the present moment and kind of also reflect, kind of rewind to our memories and fast forward to see our fate, kind of will all work out. And I didn't only write this song for myself, but also for my classmates, because I know we're all going through this, not only just with college, but our other personal endeavors. The second song I sang is called Her, the one I sang a cappella. This is dedicated to my sister, Kaysri, and this song is not solely about our relationship, but also about a sibling's relationship with someone who has autism. Having a sibling with autism can be challenging at times. There's definitely a lot of differences, but it's also such a beautiful thing. And I really want to describe that in my music. And I wanted people that have a sibling with autism to know that they are heard and that it's, like, I can relate and we can all relate and it's okay. And I think this song is also a great example of how songwriters can express their relationships within their music. Writing my EP was a journey, to say the least. I went through many steps and had a lot of trial and error, but ultimately I learned several techniques and ways that kind of helped me write my songs to the best of my ability with the time I had. So to rewind to last summer, I started writing classes with one of my mentors, Shane Adams. Shane is a professional songwriter and a teacher at Berklee College. And before our first session, he told me to listen to my favorite songs and ask myself, what makes this my favorite song? What lyrics speak to me? What emotions do I feel or hear? I gathered my observations and over the course of our sessions, started writing and incorporating similar themes that I saw or heard in different music into my own. Then I wrote the melodies. I actually wrote the melodies first before my lyrics, and whenever I had a tune in my head, I remember I would like run to my house, go straight upstairs, close the door, and just record myself singing because I just did not want to get it out of my head. So in my voice memos app, there's like thousands of just like 5-minute audio clips of me just going like, ah. So I have something to work with. So ultimately, from the writing process, I really went back to kind of Shane's advice that you can have many influences. And so he really taught me that you can find inspiration in anything to help you write. So that summer, I wrote around 5 songs, one of them being Her. Then college applications came around, all like the senior year things, and I took a little break. And when I went back and started the writing process again, I looked back at my previous songs and I saw that they didn't resonate with me as they once did. I really realized that I'm constantly changing as a person. I have grown so much, even in the course of 5 months. From this, instead of kind of getting upset and thinking, oh, I have to write more songs now, it's gonna be kind of stressful, I really just wanted to think to myself, what did I want my message of my EP to be? What aspects do I want to show about myself and my life?
I return to Shane's advice and try to find inspiration and influences for my everyday life, what I was experiencing in the present moment, what I've learned about myself, and my personal growth. Hence, Sane, and another song you'll be hearing later, was born. Next, I started the recording process with Roy Campanella. Roy is a professional audio engineer and music producer. I remember after my first session, I remember going home, listening to myself sing, and fixing something in every one of the songs. Over time, I started getting the hang of recording and finding my sound, and I worked with several different backing tracks. I experimented with like bass, cello, like all these like kind of, you know, music, a bunch of things. But I realized after kind of looking into all these different, you could say, sounds and music you can add to your voice, that I just really wanted to highlight kind of my own instrument myself. I didn't really want to add too much. So now I'm going to be describing my third track, First Place, which is about my self-growth. And it is so easy to revel in the bad thoughts about yourself. And I remember, especially just during my 4 years of high school, I used to think really poorly of myself. And I never really thought of myself as the highest level that I really should have. And I knew going into this that I really wanted a song to be about that, but I didn't want it to be sad and just kind of depressing and just talking about like how I felt back then. I wanted it to be a progressive song, kind of how I've changed and how you can change too. And so I really hope that this song reminds you that you are always first priority in your life and you should never think of yourself as any less. And you'll notice in the song my voice goes in several octaves. There's they're slightly different from my previous two. There is some instrumentation here. I really experimented a lot with it. And of course, I'm a perfectionist, so I could think I could change so many things, of course, but I think with the time I've had, I'm pretty happy with how it turned out. So here's my snippet of my recording of First Place. And here's my EP cover. Yesterday, but he was very, very patient with me through the whole process and took
this time to help me create something that I will always forever cherish. I want to thank Mr. Stevie, my in-school mentor, who helped me a lot with my presentation, and Ms. Monsignoni as well. She's been very excited about this since the very beginning. I also want to thank Ms. Cole for being very supportive, and my parents for who I'm very, very lucky to have. They have supported me through this in every single aspect, and from finding help, people that could help me support, for just being kind of my cheerleaders throughout the way, and I'm just really grateful. And to my sister, who one of the songs is dedicated to, and I'm just really thankful that we can share our love of music together. And truly, I think my EP started because of her, as well, also her being the song, and that I first started with, and then also just, she really kind of sparked within me that this is something I really wanted to do, and I'm just so thankful to have her in my life. And lastly, I want to thank my classmates. They helped me pick the album cover you saw. I was going between two, yeah. And for being super interested in the whole entire process. And I want to thank all of you for listening and listening to my recording and everything. And yeah, thank you so much.
You mentioned in the beginning that before you started, you listened to your favorite songs. Who are some artists that you have drawn inspiration from?
Yeah. I think what was really cool about that part of it is I kind of discovered a lot of music I didn't listen to before, and then also went back to a lot of artists that I loved. So a lot of my songs were from, I think, inspiration from like Bruno Mars, Harry Styles, a little bit of the Beatles, kind of like the mixture of a lot of things. But
What's the future of this EP and future ones? Where do you see this going? Are you going to share it?
Sorry, I forgot to mention. This is actually on SoundCloud if you want to listen to it now. I'm not really sure. I mean, this is kind of like a project I kind of geared towards just like showing my journey through just kind of what I've learned. And so for me, it's kind of a more personal thing. I don't think it's going to be at the professional level, but kind of regarding making another one, I feel like I definitely would in the future, just to kind of see, one, if I find more time also to kind of explore the kind of other aspects of my voice, and then also to tailor with kind of new genres and other things. So it's definitely a lot of fun.
You talked about how your mentor said that if you were having kind of writer's block, that you could really draw inspiration from anything. So, do you have a memory, a specific time where you drew inspiration from something that you were not expecting at all?
Yes. Same, actually. That song I wrote, I think, a week before recording, because I remember I was going through like all my songs and thinking, what can be my third song? I was kind of freaking out a little bit. And then that's really when I took his advice to heart. So, I remember I was actually in school, and I was just kind of noticing what's going on around me. And it was actually just all of us on our laptops kind of stressing out about college or just other things in the future. And I was like, how is this like gonna help me write a song? But then I realized I could write a song kind of how to not be as stressed about the times that I'm going through and kind of have a positive outlook. And so that really helped me kind of just looking everywhere for inspiration, which sounds kind of cheesy, but it really did help me.
I noticed that the cover that you chose, the foreground where you are, seems to be black and white while the background is in color. What was the design choice behind that?
To be really honest, I thought it looked cool. I'll be like so honest with you. And and then also my mom, she was like, let's try two colors. And I was like, no. And then I liked it. And also my best friend I know took a picture, so.
You said that music was always important to you the whole time that you've been here. Do you feel that you could go into something like a music therapy where you can help people through music?
Oh, I never thought of that. I never really, like, I don't know if personally I want to be like a singer when I grow up, but it's definitely something I want to continue, not only for kind of other people, you could say, but also for myself. I find it's very healing for me. Even when I'm stressed, I sing all over the house. My parents, my family knows. I think it really helps me kind of calm down and be in the present moment. And I also just really love it. So it's definitely going to be in my future one day.
How did you come to the name for the album?
Yeah, I wish I had a deeper story for you to but it was, my mom and I were on the couch trying to do, like, think of names, and then I think I said, like, yeah, and then Ashy Is or something, and then she's like, wait, Ashy Is. I was like, Ashy Is, and then Ashy Is. And then also it kind of, kind of going deeper into it as I kind of picked the name, I kind of realized it really stayed true for all the songs, because it's kind of how I am within the present moment, how I am, my emotions, and then how my sister is, and kind of her life. So it really worked.
So I love the process that when you were recording, you said you would think of the melodies first, right? Mm-hmm. And then you would write the lyrics. Was it hard? Did you find that it was hard, the process of incorporating and matching them, the lyrics that you wrote to the melody? How was that process with you?
Yeah, it was definitely really hard, because normally I think a lot of people think you write the lyrics first and then the melodies, but I found this way to be a lot easier for me. I think I went back actually a lot to what I learned with my mentor and how kind of different melodies kind of combine to different emotions. And so I listened to something that I recorded with myself and I thought, what does this kind of portray? Is this more somber theme, more energetic? And then I wrote the lyrics kind of based on the emotion I felt with the melody that I created.
You like better songwriting or singing?
Ooh. Singing. Songwriting is a lot. Singing is fun. Yeah. Any other questions?
Yeah. Was there anything that surprised you or stood out to you in the actual process of, like, going? I assume you went to include, like, going and recording in an actual, like, professional setting.
Yeah, I think just listening to my voice after, I was like, ooh, I can fix the little things when you're in there. But I think that really just surprised me, kind of hearing your voice also just, like, from another perspective and also just a different light. But I think over time I really started to appreciate my voice a lot more. So. Okay.
Sorry, have you taken any voice lessons?
No, I haven't.
Wow.
I did. Like, I think, actually, no, that's a lie. I took some, like, Indian classical voice lessons a couple years ago, but nothing kind of related to the music I sang today.
So, just a follow-up, would you be interested, like, are you interested in, I know you love to sing, but you're interested in formally working with your voice?
I don't know, I've always thought of it, to be honest. I think definitely in college I would love to, like, kind of minor in maybe singing or theater, something that I would use my voice more, and maybe kind of get more training, because we all, you know, have a long way to go and everything, but, yeah.
Your voice is recognizable. You might consider singing as a profession, but it's a compliment.
Oh, well, thank you. I really appreciate it. Yeah. We'll see where the future holds. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Hello, everybody.
I'm not
going to say my name, but it looks like my name. So my senior project, I chose Fox. Why did I choose Fox? Well, I love to work out and get in shape. And I also knew boxing was a very competitive and physical sport. And if you know me, I love that. And I also want to learn how to punch. I started on December 1st, and my first day was rough. It was so rough. I was sweating so much, it was dripping in my eyes. I have never experienced anything like that, and it was a lot. And my coach, thank God, he's a great guy, he would always say to me, let's get to work, come on, let's have some fun. Every single time he said that, it just got my spirits up, and I kept on going. Now, normal session, we would start with some either shadow boxing or warming up on the bag, and then we get into some pad work, and then we end with some footwork or some sparring. Now, I'm going to show you some videos, and in these videos, they have my, I work on my footwork and some of my hands and my pad work.
Nice, come on, good.
So there I'm working on my my jab and my
good, nice, come on, good work, good, come on, nice and straight, good, you get turning, good, nice stiff.
Then my jab again, the jab is super important, and just try to work on that and advancing forwards and backwards.
You're sending it straight. Nice. Make your way out. Good. Good. Nice. Good. Nice. Good. Nice. Good. Nice.
Good. That's just the freestyle, and that was my first time. So as you can see, my rhythm was off. We start a session. I'm going to start with just practicing our hooks for like 2 or 3 minutes and getting super tired, and then I'll freestyle. And he would want to see how I would react and how I breathe and what would happen. Shots. So if I punch twice, then he punches twice, and I just have to try to block it. And I was doing the push-ups because I said sorry. I didn't know I wasn't supposed to do that, but I learned my lesson. Now, there were many challenges. First, my legs were very stiff. I have to learn how to loosen my legs a bit and move around more, and also get lower. I had no idea how low. It was supposed to be this low. I didn't know that. And my punches, I used more of my upper body, and you wanted to kind of use more of your whole body and a bit of your feet. Now, oh wait, there's different types of boxers also. So there's more offensive and defensive boxes. I haven't figured that out yet, which I am, but I'm hoping to. And every boxer also has a rhythm, and I also need to find that, but I will in the future. So, can you please come up? I want to show you a little demonstration of some cat.
You made me look a little crazy. I'm not sure. Alright, let's have some fun now. Let's just see some people. Come on, ready? Alright, let's start off. We're gonna start off really simple, okay? Let's start off with a jab. Nice. Jab. Good. Nice. Jab. Good. Now let's jab, and we're gonna drop on that jab. Second jab. So up top, down low. Nice. So up top, down low. Alright, so that's real simple. Now we're gonna go freestyle. You ready? So let's 1-2. Good. Stay nice and low. Keep that nice and straight. 1-2. Good. Let's do 1-2. Slip. 2. All right. Let's go. Just like that. All right. Move with me just like that. Move over here. Good. Move that way. Over here. 1-2. Slip. 2. Slip. Woo! 2. Let's add a roll there. Let's show off now. You ready? Roll. Good. 2-3-2. Good. Keep that hand nice and high. 2 roll. 2-3-2. Good, nice. Ready? Now you're gonna roll under, uppercut, both hooks. So you're gonna roll under right here. Good, uppercut, both hooks. All right, you ready to add it all together? Real slow. All right, real slow. You ready? 1-2, slow 2. Roll. 2-3-2. Roll. Under, right here. Good, nice. Let's see it again. All right. So 1-2, slip 2. Roll. 2-3-2. Good, under. Right here, uppercut. Just like that. Now let's add some speed to it. Alright, let's add some speed. Breathe. Pace yourself. Jab. Good. Right here. Jab. 2. 2 uppercut. Good. Dig that. Stay on that front leg. Right here. You want to pop the chin? Sorry, guys. Pop the chin. And once you pop it, come up top to the temple. Okay, so here, here, here. Good. Just like that. Right here. Here. One more time. Good. Let's go for the combo, man. 1-2. Roll. 2-3-2. Good, nice. Let's do the triple, the double, and the triple in between. So here, right here, 2-3-2, double, triple, roll. Right here. Let's add that in there. All right? And let's show up all together real slow. 2-2, slip, roll, 2-3-2, double, fetch, triple, roll. Right here, over here. Right there, all together. All right, let's hit it again. 1-2, slip 2. Roll. Double. Triple. Roll. Right here. Here you are. Here. Good. Nice. Stay on that front leg. Pivot with me better. One more time. 1-2, slip 2. Roll. Here. Good. Double. Triple. Roll. Under. Right here. Nope. Good. Nice. Let's see. Uppercut. Uppercut. Power shots. Hook. Follow me. Hook. Both hooks. Good, both hooks. Good, 2-2-2. Uppercut. Uppercut. Both uppercuts. Come on, Alex, both uppercuts. You tired? Both uppercuts.
Go, Alex, go, Alex, go! Alex, go! Woo!
Alex, almost done. Double. Double. Triple. Two roll. 2-3-2. Jab. Jab. Same hand, uppercut. Good, right there. Get under there. Right there, one more time. Ready for the burnout? Let's do it. Burnout. We're doing 1-2. Real slow. 1-2. Just right there. We're gonna build. Keep it straight. Just like that. 10, 9. Come on. 8, 7. You got 4.
Go, 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 go.
Sister and Dad, Shem and Aiden, for coming.
No.
watching me and then taking some of the videos for me. Mr. Longthorn for trying to keep me on track. And of course, Aaron, thank you so much. Class for inviting me up to start boxing. Any questions?
Noise.
For breathing and also with combo. Okay.
What's your favorite combo?
I think the one we just did on stage, the jab jab and the roll. That one we just showed.
So it occurs to me until I actually saw you boxing, but what is it like to punch with your left hand?
Oh, the reason why there's so many videos of me jabbing was for me to get used to that, so it took a lot of work, but it was strange at first, but now it's kind of getting normal.
What was your biggest learning curve?
Get low. I gotta get real low. I had no idea. Yes.
Which muscles you need to use the most, or you were surprised that you really needed to have strong?
After my first day, my back was killing me. My back was really hurting.
Do you see yourself continuing this in the future? Like, maybe as a fun hobby, or going like a little bit more serious, like getting yourself in a match or something like that?
Definitely. I'd like to keep on doing it and maybe get as many as possible.
Have you noticed any principles of boxing leak into your actual life outside of boxing?
I guess, I mean, the working out definitely helped me more calm and everything, but I guess it can kind of give me more confidence.
Yeah, that was my question. Do you feel confident, I guess, or more confident in de-escalating a fight now that you know boxing?
So now that I kind of know how to throw some hands, I know that I don't have to. Talk about.
I have a couple questions. First, how padded are the gloves? Second, do you ever like tape up your wrists or anything in practice? And
no, I haven't taped it before. The glove, they're pretty padded enough, so it doesn't hurt that bad.
Could you also tell us about other equipment that you use? Your coach mentioned the headgear there in the video.
Yeah, you can use headgear. I didn't, but I definitely am going to have to get a mouth guard. I really do not want to lose any teeth. But yeah.
If you're at the end, that means a fire. What's
the question?
The question was if you're in a pot, who would win?
Can you see that?
I noticed, like he was telling you, a series of things to do and duck and everything. In boxing, is there like if you go into a ring, would you be given a sequence of throws and ducks and stuff in a fight? Like, is it orchestrated like that?
No. He says that, so I learn it and I can process it. But then they're supposed to get ready for a ring. So if you see something like that, like a jab, someone's jabbing, can move, so he's doing the movements that you see in boxing, but it wouldn't be told to you. You just have to remember. Yes.
Do you ever enter a headspace while boxing, like a concentration? And if you do, how would you describe that headspace?
I guess it's just me in my head telling myself to keep on going. A lot of times I'd be so tired. But I know I have to keep on going and just pushing myself more and more every day.
This question was,
how would boxing affect your mentality, not just in the gym, but in your life?
At first I didn't really know how much thinking it was in boxing. I thought you just had to know how to punch and dodge, but there's so much thinking, and it absolutely changed my way of thinking on perspectives of life and work and everything, so it's done a lot.
Since you've started boxing, you found that you become stronger with your weightlifting? And what are you benching now?
I think 130.
Okay.
Yes. Alex, I know you're doing the boxing and you're also doing a lot of work at the gym. Do you see yourself, besides possibly going into boxing, mm-hmm. like in the ring, but what about the other side of it, being the trainer and you know, sharing that and working with other people? That's what I want to do. Of course, I'm going to try to build my band, so I can do that.
Yeah.
But I also would like to do personal training, and I think I can use my knowledge of working out and now maybe some boxing knowledge to help train other people.
Has having learned the moves, has it changed the way you see boxing in movies? And what's your favorite boxing movie?
Yes, it definitely changed my way of thinking of boxing. And also, it's like, if that person got hit with that punch, there's no way they'd be still standing. So, yeah.
Do you have a favorite? Rocky IV?
Yeah.
In the video, there were times where you would get hit in the ribs. Was it like a tap? Was it a little more than a tap? Were you a little like bruised? Or what kind of pressure is there when you are doing that kind of sparring where you know you're not trying to hurt your opponents, you're just trying to learn?
Yeah, we call ourselves a family, and we think of it more as teaching the person that you're fighting and trying to hurt them. So we're not, since I'm a more beginner, he was boxing for many years, he knows to take it down a notch and a level, but it definitely still hurt enough to be like, oh, don't do that.
Have you done any other martial arts? And if so, what's the crossover and differences?
I did karate as a kid, but it's been a while, and I have to say, I'm not sure.
So, have you found that this form of physical exercise, as opposed to other exercises, give you something different internally, like empowerment, or do you find that boxing through this journey gives you something internally that is beneficial for you, like besides the physical in your body?
Definitely not giving up. Keep on pushing, and you're gonna get knocked down. You're just gonna get back up. Mm-hmm.
So you said your first session was December 1st. Mm-hmm. So that's like barely 4 months ago. How many times a week did you guys work out?
I try to work out at least once a week on Thursday, but sometimes I don't have gig or a basketball game or orchestra performance. So. Yeah. Thank you.
All the presentations for today. Just one thing before we all leave is our senior credit flight will be Rumors, and it will take place on May 25th, 26th, and 27th. That's all we have for you tonight, and thank you for coming.